These people are citizens of St. Lucia, a tiny island in the eastern Caribbean, still dependent on Britain. 100,000 people live here. They're not the poorest people in the world. At least they eat enough to stay alive. And most of them earn a little money. But by the standards of the rich countries, they're very poor indeed. The typical American earns 15 times more than the typical St. Lucian. For the people of St. Lucia, sunshine and waving coconut palms are no longer a substitute for schools, hospitals, better homes and fatter pay packets. Living next door to North America, they're well aware that the world is divided into rich and poor, and that they are among the poor. Others have become rich, why shouldn't they? Twenty years ago, most St. Lucians still worked on sugar estates, as they'd done ever since their forefathers were first brought to the island as slaves. Then the sugar industry collapsed, so the island took up growing bananas and selling them to Britain. In a good year, bananas now make up nearly 90% of total agricultural exports. The banana industry in St. Lucia and three other Windward Islands was started from scratch by a British firm. The British government and the British taxpayer helped. So does the British housewife, who pays a little more for St. Lucian bananas than she would do if she was allowed to buy cheaper bananas from other parts of the world. These bananas have a guaranteed quota on the British market and pay a lower rate of import duty. As well as buying bananas from St. Lucia, Britain also helps the island's economy in many other ways. We have an aid program there which last year worked out at nearly £9 for every man, woman and child on the island.
Mr. Bell, what is the purpose of aid in this part of the world?
To give these islands the chance of standing on their own feet in an economically competitive world. This means, in effect, making the best use of their own natural resources, either people, particularly people, for what they can produce or what they have. Crops on the one hand, sand, sea, sun on the other.
As a source of income, bananas are obviously better than nothing. But, like many of the tropical crops on which the poor countries are forced to rely, they have their drawbacks. One is the weather. St. Lucia has suffered two bad droughts in a row which have halved production. Another is the price. The fruit costs about 10 pence a pound in a British shop. In St. Lucia, the farmer gets just under one new penny a pound at present, sometimes even less. One advantage of bananas is that they are a crop that the peasant farmer can grow. There are big estates in St. Lucia, but nearly half the total production comes from small farms, and there are now 17,000 of these. The introduction of the banana has gone far to transform St. Lucia from a nation of feudal labourers, the descendants of slaves, to one of peasant farmers making a living from their own land. These people work for one of the more prosperous peasant farmers, who employs 20 men and women on his farm of 100 acres, 30 acres of which are planted with bananas. He pays them the minimum agricultural wage, just over £3 a week for men and less than that for women. Not princely, but better than the 35 pence or so that St. Lucians used to earn from the much nastier work of cutting sugarcane. If the banana industry fails, these people will be unemployed. They might be able to grow enough food to exist, but they'd have no money to buy anything else. The general manager of St. Lucia Banana Growers Association, Sam Gage, represents the small-scale farmers.
Oh, their lives have been altered tremendously. We said before that it has transformed them from estate workers into business proprietors. A greater turnaround of monies coming through their hands. They have better homes. They now lead a better way of life and a higher standard of living. And as long as the industry lasts, it will continue to assist in this particular
way. But in practical terms, what actual improvements have their lives seen? I mean, can you specify a few ways in which their lives are better now than they were 5 years ago?
They live in better homes. They they eat more and better foods. They wear better clothes. And there's generally more activity in the rural areas, social activity in the rural areas, than they enjoy the home.
But the banana industry is now in trouble. If it is to survive, it must increase output, reduce costs, and improve quality. This is where British aid comes in. And the biggest single item in the aid program is roads.
Roads play a very important part in our industry. Initially, it opens lots of new lands that were formerly inaccessible. And then in the more refined sense, it has a very important part to play in the quality of our bananas. Poor road surfaces and you cannot get a quality banana because there's a tremendous amount of damage between harvesting the bananas in the fields and the final condition in which it is shipped from our wharves. So in this case, roads is a tremendous assistance. We have had the benefit of maybe the major assistance on our main roads, but this effort would need similar activity on our feeder roads because the problem of surface is even more important on our feeder roads where the bananas are coming from in their raw stage.
Why is that? Why is it more important?
Well, they're more delicate. The banana just harvested is more delicate and more prone to damage in that stage.
St. Lucia is a mountainous country and its roads are terrible. The island is only 25 miles long, but it takes 2.5 hours to drive from one end to the other along the main highway. Adequate roads are needed for almost any kind of development. The banana crop loses an estimated 40% of its value on the way from the tree to the ship, partly because of the bruising the fruit gets on the road. And without proper roads, less land can be profitably used for growing bananas or any other market crop. Britain is putting up the money and supplying the engineers for a major road improvement scheme costing over £1 million. The work is carried out by the St. Lucians themselves. Much of the equipment is British. Faced with the urgent need to jack up its banana industry or go under, St. Lucia must have top-class expert advice on how to do it. This is the banana research station which carries out research for the industry throughout the Windward Islands. Many of the senior staff come from Britain and we pay their salaries. British money built the station and still meets nearly half the running costs. One reason why banana farmers in these islands lag behind their competitors is that they produce an average of less than 4 tons an acre. The bigger states in Central and South America can easily double that. Here at the research station, they managed to get a yield of 40 tons per acre. By using the same techniques, St. Lucian banana farmers could well bring their old yields up to, say, 12 tons. If they did that, it would make all the difference between a hazardous future and a secure one.
The problem is fundamentally one of quantity, but from this the quality problem derives. One of the most heart-rending situations is when one's working at a buying point and an old lady comes in who perhaps has only 3 bunches for her week's income and they're not up to standard and you're forced into the position of having to reject them all. On the other hand, if she were producing 10 bunches from the same piece of land, then if you had to reject 3, then she would still have 7 which she could sell. And furthermore, this method of transporting the fruit enables any small grower to get perfect fruit from the field to the boxing station, so that in fact there isn't any need to reject anything.
Meantime, I must emphasize that this disaster, coupled with last season's very disappointing tourist figures, could mean a very serious setback to the economy of St. Lucia, to which, of course,
the British Development Division under William Bell supervises hundreds of such projects throughout the small islands of the Caribbean.
I've also had a similar appeal from the Premier of Dominica, where a near hurricane has flattened about 30% of the banana crop.
Mr. Bell's operation now administers more than 10 million a year of British aid. It's unique in being the only British aid mission actually in the field.
Speed of development in these islands is governed far more by capacity than it is by cash. That's a generalism. By capacity, I mean capacity across the board, the supply of trained people, the availability of trained people to plan, to execute. The availability of skills and techniques. Let me give you an example. One could perhaps double, let us say one could double the amount of aid going into St. Lucia in any year. But from my assessment would be that they couldn't use it. In other words, the amount of aid that goes in these days is dictated far more by the amount that can be used than by the amount that some pundit in Whitehall allocates. Capacity is the key. You can't build up capacity till you've built up your educational system, you've built up your construction system and so forth. This is what governs the pace.
St. Lucia is a tiny island with a simple economy that is hungry for development. Poor though it is, at least it knows what needs to be done. Nearby Trinidad is much more highly developed. Its big problem is to spread the benefits of development throughout the whole population. Despite a flourishing oil and chemical industry, Trinidad has a very high rate of unemployment, 14% on the official reckoning, and some alarming pockets of poverty. This shanty town is due to be knocked down in the near future. But the people who live there declined some years ago to move to excellent new government housing because it meant leaving the rubbish dump from which many scratch their living. The government now plans to move them only a few yards away. One of the ways the rich world helps the poor is by giving aid to train skilled people. The poor countries need skills even more than they need cash. Trinidad has reached the stage of part training some of its own doctors.
Symptomatology of dysphagia and the differential diagnosis of the case of dysphagia. Now, what will then be the causes of dysphagia?
But if the rich countries then entice away the skilled people when they are trained, are they really helping? Britain could hardly keep its national health service going without doctors and nurses from Trinidad and other Commonwealth countries.
Why do any of you think that so many people do leave?
I think the basic problem here is that a lot of us are accustomed to a certain standard of medicine. And it is unfortunate that when we come back home, we see conditions that are not conducive to our idea of scientific advancement in medicine.
What do you propose to do?
I too intend to do a postgraduate degree, you know, abroad. And I too will be coming back ultimately to the best of these, to practice.
You will be defying the statistics which suggest that you are unlikely to come back and that you will stay and enjoy the standards of the richer world.
Well, I will stay and enjoy the standards of the richer world for some time, but ultimately, I mean, you know, I don't know how long your statistics have. Well, you know, what period of time you've covered, but I mean, 20 years' time I might be back here.
In 20 years' time?
15 years' time, yes.
So the island is going to have to wait a long time for your services?
Well, the island will have to wait a long time for my services, at least initially, 5 years. And, yes, a long time. 10 years, 15 years.
Can you explain to me how a country like your own can get better if expensively educated people who are needed all leave?
Well, it is a vicious circle in that unless incentive is provided to stay, these people leave, and these are the people who are sorely needed. They are the ones who must come in and give everyone a boost to work hard and to bring some of their scientific training into the hospitals, into the whole of the social life.
So that you think this is essentially a classic case of one of the problems of developing countries?
Yes, I think so.
Trinidad gives us a glimpse of the more complex problems that come with development. But Trinidad is rich enough to do without foreign aid. Another independent Caribbean country, Guyana, still relies on it heavily. Guyana's coastal strip, where 90% of the population live, is below sea level. Without sea defenses, Guyana would cease to exist. They are paid for by aid. The present phase of the sea war program will cost £7 million, £3 million in the form of loans from Britain. These mean contracts for British construction firms and orders for British equipment. The money we lend Guyana to buy goods outside the country has to be spent in Britain. It is tied, like most of the aid that the poor countries get from the rich. Guyana has a big mining industry that produces bauxite, the raw material of aluminium. As part of its policy of greater self-reliance, it nationalized one of the bauxite companies and found itself in a major row. Its Prime Minister, Mr. Forbes Burnham, like some other third world leaders, has growing doubts about aid. He fears its political strings, he criticizes its terms, and is worried about its effect on national morale.
For
Prime Minister, you're on record as saying that aid is raid. What are your objections to aid?
It's not so much my objections to raid, but my objections to the form which aid takes. Normally, the countries giving aid insist on your using up practically all of the aid which they give in purchase of their goods and services. And as a former president of the World Bank has pointed out, this normally means a loss of about one shilling in the pound of aid to the recipient of aid.
Some of the donors or lenders of money for your seawall project, notably Britain, do allow a proportion, I think it's 40%, of the money they give you to be spent locally, don't they?
Well, that was in the case of the British. They have not been as bad as the others. But the other objection, of course, is that they prefer to identify the projects in which you'll spend aid rather than giving what we want, which is program aid for an entire development program.
It sometimes appears that within the poor countries of the world, that a sort of rhetoric is used, particularly in addressing large audiences, with slogans that aid is exploitation, that aid is raid, and so forth, which must rather discourage the donor nations.
Well, in my case, it's not idle rhetoric. It arises from a study of our facts. And that is why we have placed greater emphasis on national self-reliance. Because in my view, aid can never build a country. It dehumanizes the individuals and makes them lose confidence in themselves.
Well, if aid can't bridge the gap between the rich world and the poor world, what can the poor countries do to bridge the gap?
As I see it, there are two principal things to be done, at least, or possibly three. One, there must be a greater self-reliance and involvement of the people in the case of each of the poor nations. Two, there must be a more concerted and definitive attempt to increase the flow of trade between developing countries. And thirdly, the developing countries ought to have a rather uniform policy so that when there are resources in their countries which the rich countries want, the rich countries will be made to pay for them fairly and adequately.
Do you think the poor countries can achieve these rearrangements?
Well, I think if they don't achieve it, they'll perish.
Do you believe that there's no altruism in aid?
Very little, if any.
You don't think that the taxpayers who contribute and that the governments who persuade them to contribute are doing so out of a spirit of trying to help?
Maybe the taxpayers, but certainly not the governments. But incidentally, I don't quarrel about this. We live in a materialist world.
Prime Minister, this year you took over a large Canadian-owned bauxite company in this country. Has that resulted in pressures from the rich world on you?
Oh, it certainly has. First of all, we have the pressures from the company itself, running down machinery and equipment, making it difficult at first for us to get inputs. And then the United States representative from the World Bank opposed a World Bank loan to us for the sea defenses. And there have been all sorts of pressures. We negotiated a loan with the United States recently, and then suddenly they said they'll have to reconsider the matter for another 7 months or thereabouts.
Why did you take over the company?
Because it is my conviction, my government's policy, and my people's belief that Guyana and all other countries like Guyana ought to own and control their natural resources. These resources in bauxite, which are some of the richest in the world, in quality and in quantity, have been exploited by outsiders, and we have got the minimal benefits. And we proposed to the company that we took over the majority holdings. Apparently, their power psychology precluded their being able to accept that, and we had to nationalize them. That's all. It's ours.
Prime Minister, many countries in the Caribbean, though I know not so much Guyana, have been forced to look to tourism for development. Do you see tourism as a helpful development?
Well, every country must use what resources it has. Fortunately for us, God gave us dirty, murky waters, and we don't have to be the subject of these tourists. Tourism, to my mind, for Guyana is not a good thing at this stage, because it means the importation of false and wrong values and the creation of a nation of waiters. Tourism, I think, can be all right after the country has built its own economy and has an ethic, a mores of its own. and then you can afford to let people come all around the place.
Unlike Guyana, St. Lucia has no big industry and little chance of attracting it. Tourism seems the island's best hope. Already St. Lucia has three times as many hotel beds as it had 4 years ago. But tourism brings problems with it, and not only the danger of becoming a nation of waiters. It's not enough to attract rich people to St. Lucia. The money they spend must stay there. In at least one Caribbean island, 80 cents out of every tourist dollar leaves the country immediately to pay for the imported food that the tourists eat. And attracting holidaymakers is a chancy business. This luxury hotel opened just before Christmas last year and has now closed down again. It ran into problems on construction and staffing. But with agriculture and difficulties, there's nothing except tourism to provide jobs and keep the economy growing.
Tourism is something, a plus, is not in instead of something. We were in agriculture, and agriculture has brought us up to a certain point. And we do not see that with the developments in the outside world, the British entry into the common market, that we can rely too much on agriculture to push us up to new areas of performance. And consequently, we have to look to some other field. And the field that we believe that we can most easily get into is the tourist field. We are very admirably placed. The island is said to be beautiful. I think we've heard it so often that I believe it myself. We are well placed geographically between Europe and North America. There is the social and political stability. And we think that within 5 or 10 years, with a good tourist industry, we ought to be able to double our standard of living.
Tourism in St. Lucia will need careful planning. In a neighboring island, hotels were left stranded like giant fish because the government failed to lay on a water supply. If the Caribbean wants to become the playground of North America, and there are many who say that is the wrong kind of development, it has to keep the swings and roundabouts in good working order. But St. Lucia's options are limited. It has to accept the risks of relying on tourism, nor can it afford to share Mr. Burnham's doubts about the value of aid as a whole.
No, I just think it's inadequate. You remember the Pearson Commission that reported that the developing countries were not getting sufficient aid in order to develop their own natural resources, and therefore they were open to exploitation from the particular private sector of the developed countries. And as unless aid was substantially increased, the gap between the developed countries and the undeveloped countries would continue to widen. And that in itself will have the seeds of conflict that might explode in the world.
So within the rich countries, a debate goes on between those who would like to increase aid and those who think that it's a waste of money. Which side would you be on in that debate?
If I were a citizen of one of the rich countries, I'd say that aid should continue on reasonable terms, because it would tend to raise the standard of living more rapidly of the poorer countries and therefore increase the opportunities for trade beneficial to the rich countries.
Up until the 1960s, very little was being done for this part of the world. At the moment, however, per capita, a lot of money is coming in aid. Is this conscience money for a considerable period of neglect?
No, I wouldn't say it's conscience money, but I would say very bluntly that there was an awful lot of backlog to be made up in the 40s and 50s. Very little was really done in this part of the world. The 60s, the new outlook in the 60s started with the setting up of the Ministry of Overseas Development as a brand new organization. This was undoubtedly an area in which aid had not been flowing as it should have done, was not being used properly. Pretty well all these islands were on the dole, their budgets were being balanced by Britain. And it was a deliberate policy decision to put an aid management organization into the field, as it were, to step up the amount of aid and technical assistance available. Why? A, because of the backlog, and B, I think to move far more quickly towards the time when these islands, small though they are approaching economic viability. With economic independence, one can expect perhaps political outlook towards independence. But as long as you're on the dole, you're not really free of outside influences.
Many in the rich countries believe aid is money down the drain. In Britain, the aid we gave the developing countries last year came to about one cigarette a day for each of us, just a drop in the ocean of world poverty. But as the Caribbean shows, if it is well conceived and properly managed, it can work. At this festival, St. Lucians celebrate their emancipation from slavery 140 years ago. Economically, they're still far from free. Aid can help make them freer. They need it, and we can afford it.